Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD, general physician. Today we'll be discussing on another topic, that is venous disorders, that is varicose vein and chronic venous insufficiency. And this type of patient you will be coming across in your everyday practice very, very frequently. So we'll be discussing in two separate parts, varicose vein and chronic venous insufficiency. What is varicose vein? It is a dilated, tortuous and elongated veins with reversal of blood flow, mainly due to valvular incompetence. In human beings, dilated vein can be classified as varicose vein, where it is dilated, palpable, subcutaneous vein, more than 4 mm. There is another word utilized is reticular varices, which is dilated, non-palpable, subdermal vein, which are less than 4 mm. And you can come across a spider vein, or telangiectasia, or there is something called as a dermal flames or threads, which are dilated intradermal venules, but which are less than 1 mm. So this is divided into three groups: varicose vein, reticular varices, and spider veins, or we call them as telangiectasia. Now, varicose vein you can see in legs, most common. You can see in the form of hemorrhoids, classical, or varicocele, which is very commonly seen in a scrotum. And once in a while, you will see good number of people with portal hypertension coming to you with a esophageal varices. These are all dilated varicose vein. We are going to talk of mainly varicose vein in legs, lower limb. You can get it also in upper limb. So it is a varicose vein which is superficial, protruding dilated veins, not caused by deep vein thrombosis or AV malformation. Then we label that as varicose vein. Now this varicose vein we can divide into primary varicose vein, secondary varicose vein. In secondary, we know very well hemorrhoids, piles, esophageal varices, caput medusa, varicocele, superior vena cava and inferior vena cava obstruction, etc. So these are all secondary groups. It is secondary due to some other basic etiology. You can see these are esophageal varices. These are what we call as varicocele, hemorrhoids, and these are classical varicose vein. Classical varicose vein. Caput medusa, this is typical varicose vein. Caput medusa will be because of a portal hypertension. Esophageal varices will be also because of portal hypertension. And because of portal hypertension, you can get even hemorrhoids or what we call as spikes. In superior vena cava, you will get varicose vein in upper limb and dilated veins over the chest and abdomen with a blood flow from above downwards. While in inferior vena cava, you will get a dilated veins in lower limb plus dilated vein over chest and abdomen with a blood flow from below upwards. So varicose veins are dilated tortuous vein. While venous insufficiency is a condition where it is chronic abnormal blood flow in a vein leading to local damage and potential regional or global effects. By and large, we call always as a chronic venous insufficiency. So varicose vein, which is a disease of lower limb extremities. You can come across post-thrombotic disorders or post-thrombotic venous involvement, and you can come across another disease called as angiodysplasia. So chronic venous insufficiency may be because of varicose vein or varicose disease of lower extremity, post-thrombotic or angiodysplasia. And this is a spectrum of venous disorders, telangiectasia, or we call spider vein. This is classical varicose vein. This is lipodermatosclerosis, which is secondary to chronic venous insufficiency, deep vein thrombosis, superficial phlebitis. You can see little amount of superficial phlebitis. And this is deep vein thrombosis. You can have increased venous pressure. You can see the difference between the two limb, also labeled as venous hypertension, chronic venous insufficiency, and then you start getting changes in the skin, etc. Venous ulcer. So venous disease can involve superficial system, which will produce varicose veins, spider veins, venous malformation, maybe because of birthmark, or we call congenital defect, venous reflux, leg swelling, and then venous ulceration. Venous pressure during walking is called ambulatory venous pressure. And chronic venous insufficiency is labeled as, collectively described as, manifestation of impaired venous return due to abnormal venous system function. That is the wall which are affected. And majority of the time it is because of the venous wall incompetence. And less commonly because of venous obstruction. So by and large we always say chronic venous insufficiency, it is because of venous wall incompetence rather than venous obstruction. So venous insufficiency can lead to telangiectasia, reticular veins, and varicose vein. These three are the most common presentation you come across. According to Widmer's classification, 1, corona flebectatica planta paraplantaris and edema, trophic ulcers or trophic lesions, lipodermatosclerosis, atrophic blanche, and dermatitis. And last, the person will develop active or a healed leg ulcer. These are the three stages which are being described. And there is a clinical classification, etiological classification like congenital, primary, or secondary. Depending upon the severity of involvement, you can put them into 0 to 6 grades. According to anatomical classification, which veins are involved, superficial vein, perforator vein involvement, and deep vein involvement. And according to the pathological, reflux and obstruction, or combination of both. Reflux is mainly because of chronic venous insufficiency, and obstruction is because of deep vein thrombosis. So, or you can get mixture of both. So it is called clinical, etiological, anatomical, and pathological classifications. So classification can be anatomical, superficial, perforators, and deep veins. Depending upon the size of varices, thready veins or thread veins, reticular vein, these are less than 1 millimeter. Reticular vein is between 1 to 4. And varicose vein is more than 4 millimeter. And base classification, which includes all, it is called CHEAP, C-E-A-P, clinical, etiological, anatomical, and pathophysiological. This is the classification which is routinely being utilized. Well, this is separate anatomical. This is on the size. So clinical classification is 0 to 6. Etiological classification is congenital, primary, secondary, and no venous etiology. Anatomical classification is superficial, deep, perforators, and no venous localization. And pathological is reflux, obstructive, both, and no pathological. So these are the way it is being classified. So in clinical classification, C0 is, these are the clinical symptoms like heavy leg, pains in legs, pruritus, but no clinical or palpable signs of venous insufficiency. C1 is telangiectasia and reticular vein. C2 is visible and palpable varicose vein. C3 is venous edema without trophic changes. And with trophic changes, it becomes C4, in which you get atrophic blanche, pigmentation, pruritus dermatitis, varicose eczema. And when there is a healed ulcer with trophic changes, we call C5. And if there is presence of an active venous leg ulcer and with trophic changes, then it is called as C6. So this is as far as clinical signs wise, from C0 to C6. And this is the best way of utilizing. As far as etiological classification is concerned, primary, secondary. So, primary, secondary. And also they put congenital and no venous insufficiency. So it is put as EN. No venous insufficiency. EC is congenital. EP is primary. ES is secondary. And no means EN. For etiology E, this is C0. C0 is from 0 to 6. A for symptomatic, asymptomatic, or S for symptomatic. So if person is having no symptom, then it is put as a C0A. And if it is symptomatic, then C0S. So that is how it is being utilized. And here it will be E, followed by whatever is the etiology. And in anatomy, A is for anatomy. And then depending upon superficial, S. Deep, D. Perforator, P. And no venous, N. Same way in pathological. For pathological, P. Reflux, R. Obstructive, O. And when it is both, or if there is no pathology, then P is for pathology and N is for no. This is how it is being utilized. So congenital, mainly primary and secondary, are the most commonly utilized. You can put as congenital or primary or secondary or no etiology. Anatomical, superficial, perforator, dips, and no venous involvement. Pathological, reflux, obstruction, mixture of reflux and obstruction, and no pathology. Etiology wise, you can say primary pump failure, venous obstruction, and venous valvular incompetence. So these three are the main area where it is being involved. But we divide into primary, secondary. Primary varicose vein is congenital absent or defective venous valve, elevation of venous pressure, incompetent venous valves, chronic systemic disease, and infection and trauma. So those are primary varicose. So congenital abnormality is the most common cause as far as primary is concerned, while secondary is anything which raises intra-abdominal pressure or raises the superficial or deep venous pressure, like pregnancy, abdominal mass or pelvic mass, huge ascites, obesity, constipation, venous thrombosis, etc. These are all primary. Congenital, weakness of muscle, wasting of muscle, stretching of deep fascia because of a genetic defects, and there is one syndrome called as a Klippler-Trenaudy syndromes. Secondary is very commonly because of recurrent thrombophlebitis, occupational obstruction to the venous return, pregnancy, oral contraceptive pills, obesity, huge ascites, pelvic mass, abdominal mass, iatrogenic in AV fistula, deep vein thrombosis, etc. There will be many more causes also. This will be typical this syndrome. Klippler-Trenaudy syndrome. So it can be hereditary, hormonal medications, lack of exercise, surgery, or traumatic injury. Obesity, pregnancy comes another most common as far as secondary is concerned. Age over 40, typical job where long standing or long sitting hours. So pregnancy, pelvic obstruction, chronic straining, prolonged standing, prolonged sitting, constricting clothing, obesity, oral contraceptive pills, etc. Quite common. Risk factors, age more than 50, female are more prone as compared to male, pregnancy, height, left is more involved as compared to right. Genetic factors are there, strong family history, history of DVT, obesity, overweight, prolonged standing, prolonged sitting, tunicate effect like tight clothing, etc. These people are more prone to because of prolonged standing. This is because of typical posture, because of using this particular type of what we call as a high handle. So, advanced age, family history, again prolonged standing, body increase, body mass index, that is obesity, smoking, sedentary lifestyle, lower extremity traumas, prior venous thrombosis, AV fistulas, AV shunts, oral contraceptive pills, high estrogen state, pregnancy, hernia, flat feet. All those conditions are predisposing to varicose vein. This is pathophysiology which shows you very nicely. You can see this is a normal blood flow from superficial to deep vein and from that towards the heart. But in an abnormal flow, blood from the deep vein will flow towards superficial vein, and instead of going towards heart, there is a regurgitation or reverse flow, that is from above downwards, leading to venous congestion and venous hypertension. So this wall will not allow the blood to flow from deep vein into superficial vein, and direction of this wall will never allow the blood to flow in a reverse direction, this direction. So normally blood is flowing in this direction, and here it is flowing in this direction. And as far as perforated vein is concerned, from superficial vein to deep vein, not from deep to superficial. So whenever this valve stops functioning or there is damage to this, you will have a blood flow from here to superficial vein. Or if this valve does not function properly, then also you will have problem. Another mechanism is muscle pump. If muscle wasting takes place, the pump will not work nicely. You will not have blood flow from below upwards. So venous return is governed by arterial pressure, calf musculovenous pump, gravity, thoracic pump, adjoining muscles, and valves in the vein. that does not allow the blood to flow from, because of this peculiar wall, you've got a blood flow from lower extremity towards the heart. And this muscle will act as a pumping mechanism, and that will force the blood to flow from below upward. Peculiar. Blood flow will follow from there. But if this valve does not work, then you will start getting dilatation of the vein. Normally, blood will flow from superficial to deep. It cannot flow from deep to superficial. This foot and ankle movement will also help in having additional pump action and thoracic pump action because of negative intrathoracic pressure during deep inspiration. A very simple diagram showing you that, because now if the blood is flowing from superficial via perforating into deep vein, and then if it is going towards the heart, we call that as a normal. But instead of that, because of the venous wall which is non-functioning, the blood will flow in reverse direction, and that will give rise to dilatation of vein. Clear? And that we'll call as varicose vein. So because of congenital absence or defective valves, or because of elevation of venous pressure, incompetent valves, chronic systemic disease, infection, trauma, etc., you can have reverse blood flow. Reverse blood flow, and you will get varicose vein. Very typical. That clear? Because blood will flow against gravity because of all those factors. Pumping action of calf muscle, movement at ankle joint, negative intrathoracic pressure, and it will not allow the blood to fall back because of typical venous wall presentation. And because of all those factors, now you start getting vein will dilate, pooling of blood. Wall will become stretched and incompetent, and more blood will accumulate in venous system. And because of that, increased venous pressure, dilatation of veins, valvular incompetence, reverse blood flow, failure of muscle to pump the blood. Now you will get distended, elongated, tortuous veins, and these veins are friable. And that will give rise to subcutaneous bleeding, pigmentations, dermatitis, etc. This is a typical varicose vein, what you will come across. There is one theory which is being put is fibrin cuff theory. Because of incompetence, venous stasis, venous hypertension, defective microcirculation, excessive RBC lysis, can result into eczema. You will have excessive release of hemosiderin and fibrin, which will give rise to pigmentation, dermatitis, and there will be changes in the skin called as a lipodermatosclerosis. And capillary endothelial damage will result into lack of exchange of nutrients and anoxia, or we call hypoxia. There is another theory called as a WBC trapping theory, where because of raised pressure, reduced capillary perfusion, trapping of WBC, and secondary because of venous hypertension, leukocyte adhesions molecules are released. WBC will adhere to capillary endothelial cells. They will release proteolytic enzymes and free radicals, and that will produce endothelial damage, tissue destruction and local ischemia. So because of venous insufficiency, venous patency is affected, valve will fail, calf muscle pump will not be working, and there will be endothelial damage, which will produce, because of stress, increased pressure, recurrent inflammation, and alteration in relaxation and constriction. And because of valve incompetence, there will be chronic venous hypertension, defective microcirculation, RBC diffusion and lysis, hemosiderin pigmentation. So there will be pigmentation that will produce dermatitis, capillary damage, and then you will have a venous ulceration. And then it will become non-healing ulcer. So etiology may be anything, primary, secondary, or congenital, will result into venous valve dysfunction, dilated veins. Dilated vein will again result into venous valve dysfunction, and this circle will continue. And that will end up with what we call as a chronic venous insufficiency, which can be symptomatic or asymptomatic initial stage. Then you will start getting dilated veins, varicose vein, reticular veins, telangiectasia, or you might get thrombus formation, that is post-thrombotic syndrome, edema, lipodermatosclerosis, and stasis ulcer. This is typical telangiectasia, which is being produced, and you can see in this form. This is how it looks like. Little mesh of a, these are called spider veins. These are called spider veins. And this is given a name, corona flebectatica, or also called as spider veins. So these are typical. Don't mistake it as a spider nevi. Reticular veins are little subcutaneous dilated veins which enters tributaries to the main axial trunk. Those are called reticular veins. Size of spider veins is between 1 to 3 millimeter. They are less than varicose vein. Feeder veins, where you get reflux from reticular vein into spider veins, and person will have a discomfort, and cosmetically it doesn't look nice, so it is undesirable. You can see these are typical. You will see these dilated veins, and these are spider veins. Person can be asymptomatic or symptomatic, maybe because of primary varicose vein or because of secondary varicose vein. Common complaint, cosmetic purpose, pain, and complications. Person can present as a dilated tortuous vein. You can feel that on palpation. Initially, there may not be any risk for pulmonary embolism, but in case of a DVT, there will be high risk of pulmonary embolism. I've already shown you this slide. So they can present as chronic venous insufficiency, no symptoms, heavy fit syndrome, intermittent edema, in stage 3, persistent edema, hyperpigmentation or hypopigmentation, by and large hyperpigmentation. Then you start getting changes called lipodermatosclerosis, and then it ends up with eczema, and then venous ulceration. This was in 2000, it was published. While as far as varicose vein is concerned, we already mentioned no visible venous, telangiectasia and reticular vein, then visible varicose vein, edema, skin changes, healed ulceration, and active ulceration. You can see here, there is no visible veins, but person may be symptomatic. Stage 1, you will see reticular vein, or we call telangiectasia. These are typical. Then visible varicose vein, easily, even they will be palpable. Once you start getting edema, it is stage 3, and you start getting pigmentation, skin changes. You get typical skin changes and eczema. Then you can see healed ulcer. These are healed ulcer. And when you get an active ulcer, this is stage 6. There are some risk factors we have already mentioned. Gender, female are more prone as compared to male. Age, old age, hereditary, pregnancy, long standing or long sitting, obesity, prior injury or surgery, sedentary lifestyle. Symptoms which are because of venous insufficiency, leg pains, aching, cramping pain, burning, itching, etc. Leg or ankle swelling, heavy feeling, skin discoloration, open wounds, sores, restless leg, and you can see varicose vein. And then in late stages, you might see even a skin ulcer. So common varicose vein, edema, skin changes, and then you can come across what we call as a skin ulcer. Maybe a healed ulcer or acute ulcer, active ulcer. All these symptoms we already discussed because of venous reflux. In early stage, 3 common symptoms: posture related discomfort, lower limb edema, muscle cramps, and in a persistent case, pigmentation, venous eczema, lipodermatosclerosis, and then you get a venous ulcer formation. All those whatever we have mentioned before, same things are mentioned. At your leisure time, you can go through all the different symptoms. You can see here clear-cut varicose vein, edema. Varicose vein can be seen here. You can see this varicose vein. Clear? Now this is ulceration. This is skin changes, pigmentation. You can see your ulcer. You can see corona flabby ectatia, atrophic blanche. These are called thread veins, or they, you also call that as spider veins, and these are clear cut thread veins, and these are reticular veins. This already I have discussed before. So clinical symptoms. So this is the best way of describing C0, C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, C6. Classical from 0 to 6. These are all the different slides which shows you varicose vein, pigmentation, ulcer. These are skin changes. This is edema, swelling of the leg, and these are only varicose vein without swelling. This is varicose vein with swelling. This is with skin changes, and this is ulcer. Same thing. This is pigmentation, ulceration, varicose vein with little swelling. You can see this swelling. You can see the difference between these two. There is swelling. This is spider veins. These are varicose vein. This is lipodermatosis. I already shown you this slide before. This is venous hypertension. This is corona flebectasica, ectasica, chronic venous insufficiency, showing you venous ulceration. This is venous stasis, and you can see the skin changes. This is stasis, venous stasis with eczema. This is lipodermatosclerosis and healing ulcer. This is non-healing ulcer, also called as a Marjolinis Lynch ulcer. On examination, they use Be polite to the friend, consent, exposure, position, and look for the pain. Wash hand before examining the patient and cover and thank the patient presenting the finding. You do inspection, palpation, percussion, and auscultation, and then go for special test. On inspection, you look for the varicose vein distribution, ulcer, eczema, star veins, lipodermatosclerosis, atrophic blanche, pleading edema, and if there is any scar. So look for varicose vein, where they are, which part of the body. Then look for the skin changes, eczema, this is pigmentation, this is venous ulcer, lipodermatosclerosis. You can see the venous ulcer. So look for venous ulcer, eczema, this is venous ulcer, eczema, these are spider veins, or you can call that as a star veins. This is pitting edema, this is atrophy blanche, ulceration, active and healed, leaves white patches. These are atrophy blanche. These are all pigmentation, eczema, etc. So look for all these different findings. Lipodermatosclerosis. You can see this. You can see acute changes, chronic changes. These are chronic. Already we have uttered all these words. This is spider vein. This is varicose vein. This is ulcer. These are spider vein again, or we can call that as threads. So look for all these findings. These are venous stars. This is superficial thrombophlebitis. You can see that superficial thrombophlebitis. This is pigmentation with small ulcer. This is lipodermatosclerosis with ulceration. You can look for temperature, palpate for the vein, look cough impulse. There is one tap test, there is direct test, and you can even do auscultation and look for a bruit. Palpate, easily this will be easily palpable. This will be also easily palpable. And over the varicose vein, auscultate for a bruit. Particularly, it will be very common in AV malformation. There are some typical tests which are being done. Most common which is being done is called Brody-Trendelenburg test, which is for saphenofemoral incompetence. Test 2 is for perforator incompetence. There is one test called as a PERT test and modified PERT test for DVT. Tourniquet test, or also called as a Osner-Mahoner test, which is for perforated incompetence. Squaz tap test for valvular incompetence in superficial vein. Fagan test, it is for perforator. And Pratt test is again for perforator site localization. I am not going into detail regarding all these different tests. So mainly test is to find out deep vein, communicating vein, perforating vein, superficial vein assessment. So for deep vein, PERT test and modified PERT test. For communicating vein, Trendelenburg, multiple tourniquet, two-finger test. For superficial vein, Squaz test, Cherviere test, etc. The most common which is being performed is Trendelenburg test. This is Brody-Trendelenburg test. Empty the vein and apply the mild thigh tourniquets. Let the patient stand. And then you see if the vein remains empty but fills after removal of tunicates. The incompetence must be above the tunicate level. So you can identify after applying a tunicate, if they still fill up, means it is, if the vein fills before the removal of tunicate, then incompetence must be below the tunicate. And if it fills after the removal, means the incompetence must be above the level of tunicate. Then you can go for tunicate test, Perth test, Squad's test, Perth walking test, Pratt test, Fagan test, etc. These are all the different tests. At your leisure time, you can go through Homan test, Moses signs, Brody-Trendenberg test, Perth test, modified Perth test, three tunicate test, Squad's test, Pratt test, cough impulse test, then Fagan test, Yan-Ed test. There are many, many tests. These are all for surgeons. Then you can go for Doppler examination, handheld Doppler you can use, or you can use a continuous wave Doppler, etc. These are the difference between venous ulcer, arterial ulcer, neuropathic ulcer, and pressure ulcer for differential diagnosis. This can be asked in your oral. At your leisure time, you can go through more on surgical side rather than on medical side. Morely asked in surgery. So in physical examination, you can go for, we already told you, inspection, palpation, percussion, and auscultation. And you can go for what we call as a Doppler. Duplex examination will give you a lot of idea regarding size of the vein, superficial vein, site of the reflux, etc. Even perforators you can identify. So history and physical examination is a must. Doppler duplex ultrasound will give you a good idea regarding the site, size, severity of venous insufficiency and varicose vein. You can go for CT venogram or MR venogram, venography we call, ascending venography, phlebography, arteriography for AV fistula, and you can even go for plethysmography. These are all the different study which can be utilized. Venous Doppler, duplex, venography, phlebography, plethysmography, AVP, that is ambulatory venous pressure measurement, varicography, that is for varicose vein study, arm foot venous pressure measurement, routine investigations can be also done to find out the secondary etiology. Mainly we want to find out the existence, site and degree of venous reflux and confirm deep venous patency. For that, all these tests you can do and investigations. Doppler ultrasound, which is a portable bedside examination, and colored duplex ultrasound is another investigation. Photoplethysmography will give you the existence and degree of reflux. And descending venography will give you a static study. And now it is replaced by color duplex. So to find out the post-phlebitic syndrome or chronic complication of maltreated DVT, you can utilize duplex ultrasound or ascending venography. And that gives you indirectly deep vein patency. You can go for a Doppler ultrasound, or you can do even a direct rectal examination to find out the mass, etc. You can go for peripheral vascular examination, including even ABPI, duplex scan. You will have to differentiate thromboembolism from peripheral arterial disease, peripheral venous disease, and in peripheral venous disease, varicose vein from deep vein thrombosis and chronic venous insufficiency. Treatment can be conservative, like elevation of limb, इलास्टो क्रेप बैंडेज, इलास्टिक क्रेप बैंडेज, ऊना बूट्स, ड्रग्स, इफ इट डजंट वर्क यू कैन गो फॉर स्क्लेरोथेरेपी ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज अ फेगान टेक्निक वेर यू इंजेक्ट अ स्क्लेरोजिंग एजेंट इन टू द वेन and which will lead to thrombosis, fibrosis, and then obliteration of the vein. Or you can go for a surgical intervention like ligation, stripping, avulsion. You can go for sclerotherapy. You can go for radiofrequency ablation, endovascular laser therapy, endovascular ligation, stent, etc. These are elastic bandage. Or you can go for what we call as socks, elastic socks. This is a conservative line of treatment where you can go for exercise, leg elevation, compression stockings. These are all compression stockings. Any surgical treatment, ligation and stripping, phlebectomies. As far as minimal invasive procedure is concerned, endovascular laser ablation, endovascular radio frequency ablation or sclerotherapy. When you use a chemical material, we call it as a sclerotherapy. And as far as thermal is concerned, laser or endovenous ablation. And mechanical wise, you can do excision or stripping. And these are all the different procedures which are being shown here. Prevention is always better. So elevation of leg while sleeping, regular exercise, stockings, no continuous sitting or standing for more than 30 minutes. Management for superficial venous insufficiency is conservative treatment, vein ablation and surgical procedures. For venous stasis ulcer, dressing, surgical debridement, and enzymatic agents you can utilize. You can use growth factors, bioengineered tissue, etc., or skin grafting for non-healing ulcer. So mainly we divide the management into conservative and surgical. We mentioned some of those little bit in detail. This is being there. You can go through your at leisure time. So what you do in a chronic venous insufficiency is mentioned here. You can go for venous stenting or ablation or stripping or valve reconstructions, SEPs, and exercise programs. These are all the different modes of treatment depending upon your duplex scanning. If it is a DVT, you will have to go for the treatment of DVT. If there's a venous reflex, you can go for sclerotherapy or for medical therapy or surgical intervention like ligation, stripping, ablation, or you can go for sclerotherapy. So conservative, and we call sclerotic therapy or surgical intervention. And intravenous laser therapy also can be utilized. These are all different types of compression stockings which are available. Elevation, Una boots are available. Surgical ligation of perforating veins or venous reconstruction. Hello? Haan bol. Na, atyare hu ek lecture karu chu, pachi thodi kvar pachi kar. Okay. So leg elevation, compression therapy, exercise, drugs, Una boots, lifestyle changes, go for sclerotherapy or for endovenous ablation or surgical intervention. These are stockings. These are different type of stockings available. So you can have a compression stocking or intermediate pneumatic compression devices. There are different types of bandages which are available, Una boots are available, etc. There's all the different variety of stockings which are being there. There's all the different drugs which are available at your leisure time. If you are interested, you can go through. And these are surgical options, big list of surgical options which are available. So as far as surgical intervention is concerned, there is Trendelenburg operation, subfacial ligation, subfacial endoscopic perforated surgery, short form called as SEPS. There is what is called as an endovenous or endovascular laser ablation. Endovascular laser treatment. These are vascular treatments which are available. You can use a radio frequency, heat, etc. So this is sclerotherapy where you inject the drug, different materials which are being utilized. This is typical sclerotherapy. This is endovascular laser ablation, radio frequency ablation. Complications, superficial thrombophlebitis, hemorrhage, calcified or thrombus veins. Skin complications are very common, brownish pigmentation, dermatitis, lipodermatosclerosis, venous ulcer, bleeding, infection, ankle edema. You can get calcification, periosteitis, equinovarus deformity, Marjolini's ulcer. This will be complication secondary. We already mentioned hemorrhage, ulceration, phlebitis, eczema, lipodermatosclerosis, periosteitis, calcification, deformity, fat necrosis, deep vein thrombosis, Marjolini's ulcers, etc. So I end my lecture here. I hope this lecture will be very helpful to you. Thank you for taking out time. I know that your time is valuable. And I appreciate you for spending some of the time with me while listening to this lecture. I hope this will be helpful to you. You will see good number of time this particular group of people with varicose vein or chronic venous insufficiency with or without complications. So I end my lecture here.